So do you know what's gonna happen? You done all this already, as me?
I don't want to talk about time travel. Because if we start talking about it, then we're gonna be here all day talking about it, making diagrams with straws.
Was a simpler time. Remember back then, when they thought the world was going to end just because the Mayan calendar was finishing? Oh, sweet summer children. They were yet to see what was going to come in 2020. One thing that wasn't simple, however, in 2012 was Looper. The science fiction film, directed by Rian Johnson, years before he directed The Last Jedi, which caused a lot of controversy among Star Wars fans. I'm going to be really annoying and not tell you my opinion on The Last Jedi. One day I'll make a video on it, but I'm too young in my YouTube career to know how to deal with the riot that it would bring on. So let's just say it happened. Anyway, Looper, that's what we're talking about. So Looper was a science fiction film directed by Rian Johnson, and it starred Joseph Gordon-Levitt, Bruce Willis, and Emily Blunt. Spoiler alert, it's about time travel. And if you've watched my videos before, you know that that means I'm gonna love it. However, even though I'm a huge fan of time travel films and TV, I'm the first to admit most of them have a lot of plot holes. Time travel's hard to do. You can't really get it perfect. I mean, even in the well-respected and much-loved Dark, they still managed to accidentally have school on a Sunday just because they wanted the dates to line up. So you could probably already guess where I'm going with this then. So even though Looper put so much effort into the world building, they even put prosthetics on Joseph Gordon-Levitt's face, they had him speaking in a weird voice, it's called closing your loop. Which apparently makes him sound more like Bruce Willis. They went to all this trouble, but unfortunately, the time travel has a lot of problems. Now I will say, before I start breaking it down, I absolutely love Looper. I love the world that Rian Johnson created, I love the storyline, I love where it goes, even though they break a load of rules of time travel. Or maybe they don't, tell me in the comments. But I really like the film, and the dramatic reasons they do things work for me. It really works for me. But this video isn't going to be about the dramatic reasons that it works for me. This is going to be about the technical reasons the time travel doesn't work for me. So grab your blunderbuss, we've got a few loops to close. Before we collect our golden payday though, make sure you subscribe to the channel if you want to hear more TV and film analysis from me, Anthony James. Every Thursday I release a new video. That could be a dark theory video, it could be a review of a TV or a film that I've seen, or it could even be an episode of my new show, What's News, where I have a look at upcoming releases for TV and film. Every Monday, I release a podcast with my friend Conrad. He's never seen Dark before, and we're going through it episode by episode. Check it out, it's really fun. Alright, let's go take care of the Rainmaker then. So, Joseph Gordon-Levitt plays a character called Joe. Joe is a looper, which essentially means he's a hitman, but it's not really like any other hitman you've seen before. He goes out into the middle of nowhere, and then someone is sent back in time by the mob or the mafia or someone from the future. He shoots them and disposes of them. It's a clean way of killing people because they come from another time and there's no record of their death and they just get incinerated. Every time they kill someone, there's plates of silver strapped to their back. And then one day, when the mob's finished with you, they'll send your older self back, you'll kill them without even realizing it's them, and there'll be gold strapped to their back. So it sort of brings a sort of loop. You're a looper because eventually your future self will loop back, you'll kill them, and then you'll collect the golden payday. And then you'll know you have the rest of your life to enjoy with all the money you've made, but you will end up like that. So at the start of Looper, Joe hasn't received his golden payday yet. And he's enjoying living the life, earning all this money. He's having a great time with his best mate Seth, who's played by Paul Dano. Now there's some questionable time travel rules going on with Seth as well, but I'm going to cover Joe first, and then I'll just touch on Seth at the end, okay? One day, Joe gets his golden payday. It is his future self who sent back to him. However, this time, his future self came prepared, and he manages to avoid Joe shooting him and fights him off. We learn that old Joe, played by Bruce Willis, wants to try and find and kill a character called the Rainmaker, who is now the head of the mob in the future. The Rainmaker is responsible for Joe's wife being killed, so he wants to fix that. Now, there's no reason at this point in the story why we can't think that the Joe we've been following, the younger Joe, will eventually go on to be this older Joe who comes back and fights off his younger self. There's no reason why that couldn't happen at this point. However, it becomes so confusing when we're shown then the past of old Joe. So the past of old Joe that we're shown is that he actually did kill his older self, get his golden payday, and then he moved to Shanghai. Eventually, the Rainmaker sends to get him to send him back to close his loop. However, his wife is killed in the process. Then old Joe fights them off and is able to get himself in a position to fight his younger self when he gets sent through time. Right. But doesn't that mean, based on everything we know about time travel, that if he went back and changed things, so by him not getting killed to close his loop by the younger version, that should set up a whole new timeline where everything that young Joe does now isn't predetermined because he won't turn into that old Joe. He'll turn into a different old Joe in his own timeline. However, this is really contradictory to what we're shown. So first things first, we are shown old Joe being able to remember things that young Joe is doing and go and find him, like go and talk to him in the diner, because he remembers him going there, and these are sort of popping into his head as new memories because they're just being created. This is very different to the way time travel has worked in previous films. Generally, when two timelines are created, or alternate things happen in the past which create two timelines, those two timelines then become completely separate to one another. They're a fork in the road for time, if you will. They are completely separate. They definitely don't have characters who are able to read the minds of other characters within different timelines. So in Looper, we seem to have a single timeline here, which is absolutely mind-boggling, because if that's true, then what happens at the end of the film just doesn't work. Well, it doesn't work in a time travel rules perspective. Of course it works in a dramatic, it's a great film perspective. But the actual rules and bolts of the world they're creating don't make any sense to me. So, at the end of the film, young Joe is faced with a decision. He realizes that if old Joe kills Emily Blunt's character Sarah, then her son will go on to have a horrible life and become the Rainmaker. So he decides, in a completely confusing, mind-blowing decision, to kill himself. When he kills himself, it stops old Joe because old Joe fades from existence. Because if he kills himself, he can never grow up to be old Joe. Now this is absolutely mind-bendingly brilliant, but it also just doesn't work. Now, I know it was just Joseph Gordon-Levitt coming to the conclusion in his mind, so he could be wrong, but let's just take it that he's right for a minute. How can the Rainmaker exist in the original old Joe's world if old Joe never went back in time to kill his mother to send him on the path to become the Rainmaker? So the whole thing is a huge paradox. But it's not a paradox that's ever resolved. And to be honest with you, for a feature film, it doesn't need to be resolved. However, it does leave you thinking, this just doesn't work. So if we look at it in terms of the timelines, we have the original Joe, who turns into Bruce Willis, growing up, getting his golden payday, killing his older self, going on to then eventually go back in time to try and kill the Rainmaker to save his wife. This then sends the young Joe that we come to know on a different path than the previous Joe went on, which should have split the timelines into two. However, it didn't split the timelines into two. They started sharing thoughts and sharing memories. So whenever young Joe would do something, old Joe would remember it, as if the timelines were somehow connected. And then, at the very end, in the most paradoxical move I've ever seen, he kills himself, which causes old Joe not to exist anymore. But then how did old Joe come back in time to send young Joe on the path where he'd kill himself? The whole thing is riddled with paradoxes. It doesn't make any sense whatsoever. And you know what? That's kind of why I love it. Not every time travel film has to be perfect. It doesn't have to follow scientific rules and scientific principles. It only really has to be one thing. Entertaining. And you can bet your bottom dollar, this film entertained me. It entertained me even more because the time travel doesn't work. It made it unpredictable. I was on the edge of my seat because I didn't know where it was going to go. Fantastic. Now I will say, I mentioned earlier about Paul Dano's character Seth having something to do with time travel trickery going on with him too. And I'll mention that here because it comes into why I love this film so much. At the beginning of the film, Seth actually gets his golden payday first. And like Joe, his future self escapes. Now, obviously, the mob can't be having this. So they take Seth prisoner, and they start to alter his body in order to get his future self to come back. So they scar his arm, which says, go to a certain place. Now, obviously, you can understand, based on what I just said all about Joe's character arc, why this doesn't make any sense whatsoever. If Seth's future self didn't have that on his arm already, that should have created a new timeline, rather than just appearing on his arm. However, I will say, the reason why this factored into me loving this film so much is because from this point, I knew I don't know what the rules are. I have no idea what the rules of time travel here are, and it made the whole thing from this point unpredictable. I knew when Bruce Willis first appeared that it might not have happened before because I had seen this scene with Seth and his older self. It was so compelling, it was so edgy your seat stuff, I just absolutely loved it. So there you go. Looper is not perfect. I would even go as far to say as the time travel doesn't work. I'm sure someone wants to argue with me in the comments telling me why I'm wrong and this particular subsection of this textbook would... No. If you want to, that's fine, I'd love to learn. But for me, in terms of the rules of time travel in cinema, it broke every one of them. And you know what? I love that it broke every one of them. It was fantastic. Let me know in the comments what you think. Do you think it broke the rules? Do you think it followed the rules? Is there any other time travel films you'd want me to look at like this? Let me know. Make sure you subscribe to the channel if you enjoyed the video. Thanks very much. I'm off to close a few more loops.